Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to take this opportunity to express my deep disappointment in the bloated partisan bill that my colleagues are calling a COVID relief package. That's the name on the bill, but the reality is far from it. Reality is that we just passed a $900 billion package in December. The package wasn't perfect, but it was bipartisan. This one is not. The reality is that hundreds of billions of dollars remain unspent. As of last week, there were unofficial estimates of unspent or undisbursed relief that included $183 billion for another round of PPP, $199 billion for health care, $136 billion for expanded unemployment insurance, and $46 billion for direct stimulus payments. This is money we still have, unspent. The reality is that this administration can't or won't even give Congress an honest estimate of where that money is and what they will do with trillions more. The reality is that this bill is not for emergency relief, but for left-wing spending programs years from now. Nearly half of the funds under this bill won't be spent until 2022. Billions of dollars for state and local governments, mostly to blue states that imposed costly lockdowns, even though California is reporting a $10 billion surplus. Billions to bail out multi-employer pension plans, billions for subsidies to cover the cost of rising Obamacare premiums, and a massive expansion of Medicaid with no reforms to address waste, fraud, and abuse within the program. Meanwhile, a mere 1% of this is for vaccine distribution. Really? Maybe that's perhaps because the Trump administration indeed did have a plan for vaccine distribution. I don't know. Of the billions they provide for schools, less than 5% will be spent this fiscal year, with zero requirements to get kids back in the classroom. The reality is that some provisions, like a $15 minimum wage, will only hurt the small businesses that Democrats claim they want to help. Many in my district have already told me they're going to lay off workers or shut down. So I say this to my colleagues who seem to believe that the size of their heart is correlated to how much taxpayer money they are willing to spend. This is not how you help. This is not how you govern responsibly. This is not a contest to see how much debt we can rack up for whatever constituency or special interest you favor at the moment. Americans don't want handouts. They want a vaccine and they want their businesses open. They want their kids back in school because they know it's safe despite what the teachers' unions are saying. And they don't want to be told to wear three masks after they get a vaccine. If you want to work with Republicans, assess what has been spent and what hasn't, and focus on small business relief that increases jobs instead of killing them, and Republicans will be right there with you. Until then, expect some serious opposition. Mr. Speaker, I also rise today to recognize the tremendous strength of the people in Houston who I am honored to represent in Congress. As we all know, last week an historic Arctic blast hit much of the South, including the great state of Texas, plunging millions of Texans into darkness. In the middle of freezing cold temperatures, people weren't able to heat their homes or access water. I personally had to gather water from a swimming pool in our apartment complex after our water was shut off. I know that many had much, much worse than I did, but through it all, the community came together. My friend Jim McInvale, known as Mattress Mac in Houston, opened up his furniture store as a shelter last week to give people in need a warm place to sleep, eat, or just get out of the cold for a few hours. There are countless others who stepped up. Plumbers helped their neighbors repair their pipes free of charge. Food and water distribution centers opened up across the city, including at my district office. And people who had power used it minimally so electricity could flow back to their neighbors faster. This is what we call Houston Strong. It's what got us through Harvey and Imelda, and it's what will get us through this difficult time as well. And finally, Mr. Speaker, I rise today to wish a happy 50th anniversary to the Federal Protective Service. Thank you to the 1,400 members of FPS, the men and women who protect more than 9,500 federal facilities and the 1.4 million employees who work in those buildings on a daily basis. All too often, you only gain attention when tragedy strikes, whether it's the 1995 Oklahoma City bombing or just last year, bravely defending the federal courthouse in Portland. But we should remind Americans that it is every day you are there, holding the line. I rise today to tell you we are thankful and we are appreciative of your service and your commitment to keeping our nation safe. Thank you and happy 50th anniversary.